John, you bacon. We both read your book cover to cover.
Enjoyed it.
Enjoyed it a lot. Yeah, it's a really important book, I think, and we'll get into that in a moment. But first things first, the main question Jay and I had really was, what does the U stand for in John U Bacon?
And my middle name. Good luck, guys.
Well, hold on,
Ulysses.
Before you answer, we think it's probably Ulysses, which is great. Some dark horses include Uwe,
Upchurch, Underwood.
Underwood. It's a stretch, but maybe Umberto? Are we close?
I wish.
Can you tell us?
Not terribly close. No, I have too much fun leaving that MS3 on radio.
Oh, man.
But good luck with that one. I can tell you this, it is a family name. So it's Umberto, that's my all-time favorite right now. So good job with that one.
Well, anyway, getting down to it. John, thank you for coming on. We've got John Saunders' book that you've helped write, Playing Hurt, My Journey from Despair to Hope. First, how did you get involved with helping John write this book?
John and I became friends back in, I think, 1997 or so at Dave Coulier's. He's the actor from Full House.
Sure.
He had a celebrity/media hockey game at Joe Louis back in the day, which drew about 10,000 fans. We had Chad Smith, the drummer of Red Hot Chili Peppers and Net. We had the Hanson brothers were there. So
I remember that game. I remember that exact game.
Well, I was there.
Nice.
So, and so was John. And we dressed in adjoining stalls, just dumb luck, and started chatting. We kept it up for about, 18, 19 years, I guess. So we stayed in touch, had good conversations. After my book with Bo Schembechler came out in 2007, called Bo's Lasting Lessons, mm-hmm. John liked that a lot, and he wanted to start writing books with me as well. So we talked about doing a book on Madison Square Garden and began working on that. But in that process, in 2011, of course, as you know from the book, John stood up too fast at the ABC College Football Studios, blacked out, fell backwards, and John is 6'1", 225, hit the back of his head on a cold tile floor. And that, of course, had blood gushing out of his head and put him in the hospital, turned out for 6 weeks. We had to relearn how to walk and talk and read and write. And that was obviously very difficult, to say the least, and that spun him into depression as well. So during that process, John and I kept talking, and finally when he got through that period, and it was kind of close, kind of scary, he said, we have to write a book about this. And I said, are you sure? Because I don't do anything that, you know, affects your mental health, so please let me know if that's okay. And check with the doctors and all that. And he did, and it was clearly beneficial to him to tell the story. So,
well, I wondered, John, if this is, it's kind of a weird interview even to do for us, because John's no longer here, and it's an extremely personal story of his. Have you found interviews more difficult with this book than others?
It's certainly more sensitive. The good news is John had great clarity about what he thought, what he experienced, what he concluded from it all. So it's not too hard to answer the questions on John's behalf, if you will, because I knew very clearly from the book where he stood. And yet, as without question, I mean, the other book's about college football, man. We can have a debate about that. We can argue about that, whatever. But it's not life or death, and it's not so incredibly personal as John's book is. So, And I'm also reluctant to speak for John beyond what he's got in the book already talked about. But I found that interviewers have been particularly sensitive, you guys included. Yeah. They know that this is not just a rah-rah ESPN book. That
not even close.
Yeah, exactly. And the good news is that, I mean, John is a genuinely good guy. I still use the present tense. That comes across in the book, too, I think. And one of our goals, rather paradoxically, was to write a book about depression that was not depressing.
Well, I think you accomplished that. I definitely think you have. I've heard other people say this, and I think I feel the same way, that I really enjoyed the book, no matter the subject matter. It was really good. Entertaining at times. I mean, you know, he comes off as a very likable character. I really didn't know much about him personally going into it. And it's just so, you're so sympathetic to him throughout the process because he just bears his soul so much. How much of that did you have to kind of draw out of him? And how much was just like him, like going, hey, I'm ready to tell each piece of my life here? Because he had some incredible abuse, incredibly embarrassing situations.
As you know, you've already clearly read the book. It's a deeply personal look. I mean, John spared nothing in this book. Physical abuse from his father, sexual abuse from his older female cousins when he's 6 or 7, self-medication, self-mutilation, concussions, depression, almost all the hot-button issues out there right now, John went through himself. And although I had follow-up questions for John to flesh out some details about this or that, trust me, it was far more the former in your question that John was openly delivering this than it was the latter. And it had to be that way. You cannot prod somebody to talk about their lives as personally, I don't think.
No, there's a shame that kind of goes along with men discussing depression. It's like we're not supposed to be able to talk about that and man up. And so it really is kind of a taboo topic in a lot of ways.
There's no question. In fact, it was your call from the book. Joe Biden, the former vice president, was on a train with John, coming back from the White House after a White House conference on mental health that John reunited with President Obama, who happened to be a big fan of John's. And on the train right back, Joe Biden said, look, you can come out as a gay NFL player, a current one even, a gay NBA player, which both of which happened in 2012 or so, but you can't come out as a depressed or pro-athlete, pro-sports figure with mental health issues. And John realized he's right, and I have to be the one to do that, because Biden had no idea that John had gone through all this. So that's when John realized, okay, I've got to do this, because you're right, that in John's field, in my field too, it's one of the really last remaining taboos. And John was fearless about this, truly.
Well, it's funny, as an outsider looking at John Saunders, you look at him and you go, here's a guy who was a great athlete and gets this dream gig in a cutthroat industry. He's making a ton of money. He's got celebrity. Everything looks perfect. He's got the family, the kids, the loving wife and brother and sister. And I find myself like every page going, God damn it, when's this guy going to catch a break? And it's just so,
exactly.
Yeah, it's so weird. It's such a weird thing because you wouldn't know that from the outside looking in. And I think depressed people deal with that a lot, where everything looks great and people are shocked when they commit suicide, except another depressed person goes, oh yeah, I can see how that happens.
Yeah, he must have devoted a tremendous amount of energy to suppressing this from the public for so long that it had to be a huge relief for him to finally put this down on paper.
I think it was. In fact, John was already bragging a lot, not bragging quite, but feeling proud openly to his wife, Wanda, his daughters, his brother, Bernie, his friends, close friends, that he felt good about doing the book, felt good about the book itself. And without that, we would not have gone forward. But the burden John carried for so long was tremendous. And not that those things were false. John did have a great career, and he loved it. He did have a great wife, Wanda, and still supporting John. Amazing daughters I'm still in touch with. A great brother. John was not unaware of these things, and he's not unappreciative by any means. Sure. But his line about that with depression is that it's kind of like when your TV goes from color to black and white. It's still the same stuff, but it does not feel the same. It lacks the warmth. I mean, they can't reach you, basically, not because they don't want to. So that was a big part of John's life. And so what you saw was true. It just was not the whole story.
Well, he suffers from depression from very early on in his childhood. And I wonder how much you think his abusive father, his father was awful, how much of that helped his depression, or do you think it was something that he was going to suffer from even if he had a perfect childhood?
That is a great question, and one to which we'll never quite know the answer. Yeah. His brother Bernie went through similar childhood, was not nearly the targeted the way John was with the father. As John jokes in the book, John had the bad habit of opening his big mouth at the wrong time with his dad, which doesn't mean you deserve it by any means. Let's be clear about that. But Bernie saw that example in a year younger and, you know, trying to look the other way and kept quiet and whatnot. It's hard to say. Depression is a funny thing. And I don't mean that in a humorous way, of course, but people can go through the same experience, be it a POW camp, and one will get depression and one will not. A lot of it's just flat-out chemical. You're born with it or you're not. It develops and so on. Conditions can add to it. Alcoholism is certainly a factor. Drugs are certainly a factor. Often they're used to mask it. If there's one factor that probably led to John's depression, I would say it's the physical abuse of John's dad. Of all the things that I mentioned that John had been through, he was able to negotiate most of them, except for his dad's abuse lingered with John to the day he died. Yeah. And as he said in the book, that the bruises heal, obviously, but the sense of worthlessness that you get from that experience when you're 5, 6, 7 years old, getting beaten up by your dad, being called all the names in the book, he said that stays with you. And the problem with kids is when they're being abused by their parents, they don't blame their parents because that would be too scary. You have to believe the person in charge of the house knows what they're doing and has got their head together. So you blame yourself. You make a story up where you are worthless, you believe your parents, and you deserve this, and therefore you're the problem, not him. And that is the lingering factor. So I cannot answer your question with great confidence, but I can say that I think John's life would be very different were it not for his dad's abuse.
Well, one of the incredibly painful things to read about was, you know, even when John had moments, like the happiest moment of his life, he's pitching in the Little League championship game, and his dad, just in the blink of an eye, can destroy him. That was a really tough story to read. I don't know if you want to explain it or...
Sure. So, yeah, John, and we noticed, too, in doing the book, in some cases, the book actually helped John have some insights as to why his life was the way it was. His dad's worst abuse, physical and verbal, almost always occurred after one of John's greatest triumphs. And I'm not sure if that's typical amongst abusive parents or not, but it certainly was a pattern with his dad. So one of the first ones was in Little League Baseball. John is probably 11 or 12 years old, and on the team with his brother Bernie, they're in the city championship for Little Leagues. They're ahead. John's on the mound. He's the pitcher. And he's getting cocky out there and hot-doggy in the seventh inning. The other team almost beats him, but they don't, and John's the winning pitcher. And his dad is very mad at John's hot-dogging, which probably any parent would be to a point. But then John goes out and celebrates with his buddies to a pizza place. They have Coke. They play football afterwards. They think everything's going to be okay until John comes back to the house and sees his dad. And his dad says, you got to play catcher next year. John says, okay, that's fine. And he says, no, we need to practice right now. It's 11 o'clock at night. They've got a single ball out in the backyard. And John grabs his mitt, and his dad says, you don't need the mitt. So his dad, who's a good athlete, spends about half an hour burning fastballs at John with no gloves.
Oh.
So his hands get beat to a pulp. Then he starts throwing them in the dirt.
Skipping
and
into
John's
face.
Gets beaten up. It's just a horrible situation.
Wow.
And for the next day, John, wakes up with a bloody pillowcase. Looks as though he went 15 rounds, Joe Lewis. That's a classic reaction of his dad. And the same thing happened after John got a great job in Toronto, got a great job in Baltimore, got the ESPN gig. His dad is always there to knock him down.
Yep.
John got a great house in Baltimore. His dad's there to say this house sucks. So that's what his dad is all about, sadly. And I think of the day John's dad died, I think it was in 2009, it's in the book, I think that John held out hope that somehow his dad would have clarity, would apologize, would recognize what he's done, would embrace his son, tell his son he loved him. And I think when John died, that threw him for another loop, because he's kind of secretly holding out hope for that, and it never happened. And then John went into another tailspin after that.
Hey, John, skipping forward a little bit, a couple local characters, but also very well-known nationally, that played important roles in John's life at different periods. Jacques Demers and Dick Vitale, they came into his life, as I say, at different times. But what did each one of those mean to him?
Yeah, Jacques Demers. How about that?
Yeah.
Jacques Demers was John's junior coach. He also coached Bernie. Coached juniors, coached him later on with the NHL Quebec Nordiques, actually. Bernie got about 10 games with those guys, which is, I don't care how many games you got to the NHL, you're a serious player. I mean,
yeah.
Bernie clearly was. Jacques was a beloved figure, lived around the corner from the Saunders, and, for two guys looking for male role models, Jacques Demers was pretty good.
Yeah.
Very caring guy, very sweet guy, clearly knew his hockey. Of course, we've learned since then that Demers was illiterate as an adult, which was his own private shame, and he came up with that himself in his own book, and not surprisingly, the reason is partly the same. His own dad was abusive and made him feel worthless.
Yeah.
So you spend your whole life trying to make that up. But I think for that reason, John and Jacques Demers really hit it off, and they stayed in touch the day, John died. So
I
think it's pretty cool that those guys were able to keep that connection going. Of course, Demers had no idea that John would one day be as famous as he was as a hockey coach, which shows you, your character is what you do when you think no one's watching. You could have blown him off as a teenage kid, and it would have affected John pretty deeply. Demers never did that. So I count him as one of the good guys in this book, and there are a lot of good guys in this book. But Demers is certainly one of them. Another guy, as you mentioned, Dick Vitale, U of D's old coach, was very close to John. John visited Vitale after his throat surgery, which is a scary thing for a broadcaster, obviously. And, of course, John had his heart attack at Vitale's house in the spring of 2012.
Yeah, again,
now,
can't
luckily,
catch a break. I know.
Party. Yeah. Yeah, 500 people there at the house. This is a gigantic house, obviously. It's not my house. but at Vitale's house, you're going to have some great doctors there. And sure enough, Lou Holtz's cardiologist was there. And John got exactly the help that he needed and no damage to the heart muscle because they got to it so quickly and got him into surgery, 95% blockage in that operation. And this is what you're talking about earlier. At that point, you're thinking, no way, this guy's got to get a break. Yeah. But it's after that heart attack. He does wisely call his daughters from Florida and say, look, I had a heart attack, but I'm okay. I'll be home in 3 days, you know, nothing to worry about, et cetera. Called his doctors also, Dr. Carolyn Douglas. And when he went back to her office a few days after that, she said, I was afraid you were going to tell me that you wish you had died in the heart attack as an honorable way to go, a substitute for suicide, basically.
Yeah.
With all the problems he's going through during that same year. It's a six-month period, incredibly. And John said, you know, 3 or 4 months ago when he first visited the Tappan Zee Bridge, considering suicide in New York, I might have said that. But now I realize, you know, things have gotten a lot better for him, except for the heart attack. And I've got too much to live for. I'm going to enjoy the last years of my life. And he did.
Yeah.
And the sad fact is, there's only four left. We didn't know that, of course. Right. But John really did enjoy the last few years of his life. And it shows you that depression, when treated appropriately, with the right doctors, therapy, medication, whatever it takes, the success rates are incredibly high. So if somebody out there suffers from this, get help. That's the message.
And it's got to be the right doctor, though. You have a story in there about Dr. Dangerous, who you term Dr. Dangerous, and just about the absolute ridiculousness in terms of how he used a cookie cutter style to diagnose John and just ended up loading him up on narcotics and kind of like Klonopin. Set him on his way.
Klonopin was his thing, right?
Yeah. As the doctor we call in the book, Dr. Dangerous, I can tell you guys privately that we had another name for him, Dr. DB.
Dr. Dickbag.
In our conversation, we thought that would not be appropriate for a book, but yeah. John and I had a good laugh over that more than once. this guy was bad news. He kept on cranking up John's prescription for a drug called Klonopin, which I'm sure is effective in the right dosage, in the right situation.
It's very powerful.
In the wrong hands, it's very powerful. Yeah. It's an anti-anxiety drug, and John did not suffer from anxiety. So he did not need this drug in the first place. Second of all, the guy cranked him up to 4 milligrams a day, which depends on how the size of the pills goes. It could be about 40 Valium in one day, which is, that'll knock out a horse.
Wow.
And John was falling asleep a lot, and the doctor was amazed he could drive a car, so it was particularly dangerous. And combined with even a small amount of alcohol, it can create a lot of problems, and no one told John that either.
Yeah.
It took him about 3 years to get him off Klonopin. It had to be a very gradual process because, you know, it could be dangerous, and if you go too fast, you'll affect your mood. And that was one example of very poor medical care. It's the exception, not the rule in this book, but it did make clear you have to be aggressive in your own treatment. You can't just be passive and take whatever they give you. You have to investigate and ask questions.
But your takeaway message of, look, there is help out there. You got to go try and find it is absolutely, obviously a good one. And it was admirable how hard John really did try to get better. That was the theme throughout the book. One thing that seemed interesting to me, though, is a man desperate to heal. Why do you think he never sought the spiritual angle? At least I don't think religion was ever mentioned in the book.
John was religious growing up. His grandparents were very religious. Even his parents were. His grandparents were lovely people, and they were very religious. John was very religious through about high school. I think, honestly, the run through drugs and women and everything else, I think he became a lot less religious. He might have become more religious. I think I saw those inklings as John was older. Maybe spiritual would be a better word. Mm-hmm. But no, that was not, you know, he did not go to church on a weekly basis.
You know, Jay just pointed out how it's admirable that this guy worked as hard as he did to, you know, try to deal with the depression. I had a different takeaway, and it's, you know, I have dealt with this sort of issue myself, and not to the level that John Saunders did, but it's frustrating to read that because people that do just want, they want to know, like, okay, what do I do? What is the pill? What is the magic solution? And it's discouraging kind of to go, God, this guy worked his ass off until the day he died, he was dealing with this. And so, I don't know, I was like, oh, man, there's no hope.
It's a process, Mike.
Yeah, I know. I just know I don't work as hard as John, and he worked his ass off, and it was still an issue till the very end.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's the right thing to say, but that's honestly how I felt, you know?
Mm-hmm. I understand that. I can certainly say, you can see in the book, that John's life got dramatically better the last 4 years.
Yeah.
And that's why the title of the book, the subtitle is My Journey from Despair to Hope. There's a lot of hope. There's a lot of inspiration.
Sure.
John went through all these things, and none of them beat him, incredibly. And even the combination did not beat him, which is even more incredible. But it does show as far as the old school values you're talking about, the love of and caring of his wife, his daughters, his brother, his friends, these things are what pulled John through. So on some level, it's not just science. You have to grab the heart.
Yeah.
And they did. People care about you. You've got to step up to help you out. We're hoping certainly that book helps in that way as well. So.
Well, growing up, John's love obviously was hockey. He wanted to do that. Wanted to be a pro. But he kept getting hurt, and it's tough to read about all these vicious injuries that laid him up. And, you know, when you've got depression, the last thing you need is to sit and just to be in your own head. And so at that point, one of his buddies, I think, was like, hey, man, I'm working at this country radio station. I could probably get you a shift. And John just kind of, yeah, okay, and goes down there. And soon enough, Country John Saunders is born, which is kind of funny. Name two things black guys are into, hockey and country music, right. would not top my list, but he was great at them. Was broadcasting on his mind at that point, or did he just kind of fall into it?
He just totally fell into it as a lark. He had no intention to get into broadcasting. This is when he's playing hockey at Ryerson University in Toronto, and he ended up being an all-star defenseman there, a very good one. And one of his buddies said, hey, got a fill-in job. John needed a few bucks, so as you said, on Sunday mornings, he's going in there spinning Hemi Wynette and Charlie Pride and guys like this, interspersed with the recorded Presbyterian sermon, the Baptist sermon, the Methodist sermon, and so on. And that was Country John Saunders, rather humorously. But he discovered he had a knack for it. They liked him, and he was good at it immediately. Now, once he takes a few more jobs, he takes it very seriously after that, but not initially. But that clearly was a bit of a lifesaver that, you know, John needed when sports collapsed for him as a way to get out, a way to feel good about yourself. John needed some other outlet, some other way to feel like, you know, hey, I'm good at something, and I've got a home. And broadcasting did that, and John always took that very seriously, which is why when he had the concussion in 2011 and he's got problems on the air with short-term memory and things like that, that was terrifying to him because that's the one thing he could always count on. Was his ability as a broadcaster.
Yeah, he had to recover live on TV, really.
Yeah, which is not, I mean, we talk about kids growing up on TV, you know, the childhood actors, the 15-year-old athletes and whatnot, and how difficult that must be. But John had to kind of recover on air as well, which I don't think is a very easy way to do it.
And you're trying to come off a major head injury, you're trying to remember things quickly, comment on games that are going on, and he talks about slipping on a few names and then looking at the Twitter sphere afterwards and seeing all the trolls just wailing on him.
I actually, when I got to that point, it was like when John says, "Oh, maybe I'll check my Twitter." I was
No, John.
Don't do that, John. I'm like talking to myself, yelling at the book. I just
kind of like one of those murder movies, right? Where you say, "Don't open the door."
No,
you
know, don't open the door. He's down there.
And those of us in the business, you can't handle some of this stuff. You're not going to get very far doing what we do.
Yeah.
And we know that, you know, on any given night, any book you write, almost anything you do, there'll be at least one jackass out there who's got something to say about it that, you know, is irrelevant. You don't
sitting
need to hear
it. Sitting in his basement.
But, yeah.
You know, once in a while you get some smart criticism and say, okay, that guy's got a point. But oftentimes just get these mean-spirited people, and John ran into that.
Well, so. when I read that, I so recognized it. I knew what he was talking about, and a lot of people in whether it's entertainment or music or sports, you know, that have this outward personality, they're in the public eye. You know, we can get 500 emails here that with really genuine stories of your guys' show got me through the worst period of my life, you know, when my family died or someone got sick or I was in the hospital. And they're really heartwarming. And he's just like, yep, whatever, dude. And then some guy writes it and goes, you suck. And it's like, well, Pete from Lake Orion's got it right. I do suck. And it's such a weird feeling, but it's so true. And you can hang on those dumb ones like that. And I knew John would do that. I knew it when I was reading it.
It is an amazing aspect of human nature. I think it's pretty common. It's probably common to all of us. And sometimes the more praise you get, the more it rolls off your back. And the more the one or two knocks, you know, sink in a way they would not otherwise. Mm-hmm. And that's true probably of human nature in general, I think. And I always try to remind myself, read the nice ones carefully.
Yeah.
Give them the same amount of time you give the knocks. I mean, and I'm blessed as far as that goes. You know, my ratio is 98% positive and 2% negative, so I can't complain about that in this world. And yet the 2%, you dwell on. And I got to say, it's, you know, people who are going through depression, it's far worse for them.
Sure.
As John makes clear in the book, his emotional metabolism was much higher, and so he burned through praise faster, and the criticisms stuck much deeper.
Well, when you're depressed, people go through life feeling like I'm not good enough, I'm not worthy. They internalize and beat themselves up, and oh my God, I'm a fraud. They're going to figure me out soon. And so it doesn't take much. Someone going, you suck, and it's like, yep, that's what I was feeling. He figured it out. The rest will soon. And so it's a horrible prison to lock yourself into, but it is what it is.
Well, and at the same time, John,
it is what it is, and that's kind of the point, though. If you feel that way by yourself already, and somebody, you know, agrees with that point of view, that you're no good, etc., it reinforces it clearly.
Yeah.
So all of us in the world need enough self-regard, self-confidence, not cockiness, and I'm talking about that.
Yeah.
But to withstand some criticism and say, you know what, that's what they think, I'm okay.
Yeah.
And rationally, we can look at 100 other, you know, emails and praise and say, look, you know, are the 100 other people wrong and this one jackass is right?
Yeah.
Probably not. And but when you're depressed, it's more likely to give that guy a lot more credence than you should.
He's not just depressed, though. The poor guy is at that point trying to recover from a major head injury, falling off the stage at ABC.
Weeks in the hospital.
Yeah, and he's coming back too soon.
Yeah. And
so he needs the juice of it. I mean, for him, work is a drug.
Yeah.
He needs that. So it comes back too soon, and the process, look, man, I mean, what we do looks easy. What John does looks easy. We all know it's not easy. And what John had to do, of course, you've got a producer yammering in your ear, in your earpiece, 100 miles an hour, and you take what he said and say to the audience, while he's saying something else, you're listening to his first thing, saying the second thing, listening to his third thing, to make sure you get the next thing while conversing with Jesse Palmer on the set of ABC College Football or Jay Bills in basketball.
And watching highlights or watching a game in front of you, it's insane.
You got highlights coming in. You got interns jamming stats under your nose. You got about 3 or 4 records playing in your head at once.
Yeah.
You got to keep them all straight and make the whole thing sound like a waltz. And John was, if he was not the best in the business, man, he was close.
Yeah,
he sure was.
You know, Ann Arbor's own Mike Tirico is right up there.
Yeah.
And those guys were friends, not surprisingly.
Yeah.
That's his, you know, tough as it gets. Now when you start scratching those records and having mental issues, you know, issues processing things after a serious concussion, that job was a whole lot harder, and John had to do it live on national TV, which is not advised.
Well, it's a nasty feeling when you're on a microphone and you blank on something. It's a horrifying, like you go ghost white. Oh, I know you do. And so do we. Jay and I will be in the middle of a conversation. It's like, oh shit, I don't even know what I'm talking about. And then and so when John is describing being back on the air, coming out of a commercial break, and Lou Holtz is sitting there and Jesse Palmer, and he absolutely doesn't know their names. And he's got to somehow on live national TV, like, get it together and like, okay, what do I do? And then finally comes back to him. But I can only imagine the horror he's going through in that moment.
Yeah, exactly. Especially when you've had these things at your fingertips your entire life.
Yeah.
As John said, that the one area of his life he's always been completely confident is as a broadcaster. He's never struggled at this. He's always been good. And for that reason, it's a great drug for him to put his depression aside, because as you know, it's so demanding that your mind can't be anywhere else. You cannot be dwelling on your own problems, you know, your place in the world, what somebody said. You have to be completely focused in that moment, or else it will not work. And for John to start getting to struggle with that, in even a small way, was shocking and disorienting to him, very much unsettling. And I was joking, of course, man, anybody who's done any radio TV,
blanked.
We've all blanked. We've all said something that, boy, I wish I hadn't said it that way.
Yeah.
Hey, it's bound to happen.
Let me ask you about Jimmy Valvano real quick. You know, Saunders very involved in the V Foundation, I think on the board, actually. Is it a stretch to say that the legacy that Valvano left inspired John Saunders' decision to leave the legacy that he's leaving via this book?
I think yes, exactly right. Bernie said on Good Morning America, John's very close brother and closest friend, that the takeaway message for this book is Jimmy Valvano, one of John's closest friends, his father figure, his famous line, never give up, never, ever, ever give up.
Yeah, don't give up.
And that was the whole point of what John was saying, is that, look, man, I've been through 5 kinds of hell.
Yeah.
I'm still here, and now I'm enjoying life. So, you know, don't give up, don't jump, Don't check out. Get help, and things will get better. And as you know, depression is one of the most treatable things out there, that when you get the appropriate help, be it therapy, medication, whatever, the success rate is like 80-90%. I don't have the data in front of me. I'm not a scientist anyway. But it is extraordinarily high. And it's men who have the hardest time asking for help. So we're hoping that this book allows men and people who love them who are going through this a better way to get help. Because, man, there's no more macho guy than John Saunders, you know, big, tough hockey player, sportscaster, all this, good-hearted guy. He went through all this, so it doesn't matter how tough you are. If you get this stuff, you're going to go through a hard patch, so get help.
Well, I think it's a really important book. You know, there's a ton in here we haven't covered. It's a great read, and it'll be eye-opening to people who just don't understand, like, why don't you just shake it off? Tell yourself to have a good day. You know, like, it'll really kind of make sense of a lot of those things that people that are depressed deal with and people that are dealing with depressed people deal with. And so I really do think it's an important book and a great read. And we thank you for the time, John Umberto Bacon.
Yeah.
It's been a lot of fun, and I think people are really going to enjoy this book. It's called John Saunders, Playing Hurt, My Journey from Despair to Hope, and forward by Mitch Albom. Lots of great stories.
You did a great job, by the way.
Yeah.
Buy for the forward, trust me.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not a huge fan of Mitch. I know you guys are all buddies, but Mitch hasn't always been the nicest guy to me. So, but it is a great forward. I'll give him that. He's a good writer.
Hey, John, before we let you go, one more second of your time. I owe you a big thank you. You saved my sanity on a couple evenings when I saw you speak at two State Bar of Michigan events. You were the keynote. Thank God you were. I'm sitting there at these lawyer events going, oh, my God, some boring-ass guy is going to get up and talk about the newest regulations. And lo and behold, John Bacon shows up and talks about Bo Schembechler for, you know, 45 minutes. I'm like, yes! So thank you, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, lastly, John, when does the book come out? It's not out yet, is it? Or is it out now?
Oh, no. Saunders came out 2 weeks ago, and okay. It's selling very well. Yeah, we've been on Good Morning America, NPR, ESPN a ton.
And now the Detroit cast.
It'll be selling, I'm sure, well all fall, maybe well into the future, because I think it seems to be a book that doctors hand their patients, families hand their friends, and other folks just pick up and realize that, okay, this will help me get out of this.
Yeah.
And that was John, I mean, trust me, John didn't need to, I mean, we got paid well for this decently, but we spent 5 years on it.
Yeah.
So it was not the money, and it's book money, not TV money, not ESPN money.
Yeah.
So John did not need the money that we were offering. He needs to have their privacy invaded like this. So it was not for the celebrity that he needed it, of course. John did it for two reasons. One, to get it off his chest, and two, to help other people.
Yeah, it's obvious. It's obvious that he's bearing his soul to help other people. It's crystal clear in the book.
I'm glad.
Yeah, it comes through a lot, and it's commendable. It's honest. It's a great read. And John, thank you so much for the time, man. We've got your cell number. We'll probably bother you down the road sometime. So,
thanks, Les.
By all means.
All right, John. Thanks, buddy, for all the time.
Take care.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you. There we go. God, yeah, it is a great book, man. That we're not just saying that. We don't even do interviews unless we really like the book. We don't bother. There is so much we didn't even touch. I mean, getting to how he got to ESPN and SportsCenter and, you know, all the stories there. There's a ton of those. His shit mother and father. Oh. Just, dude, I wanted to fucking kill him. That suicide note when he tried to commit suicide in the bathtub. Did you read that?
Yeah.
The suicide note John had written and actually cut his veins and couldn't go through with it. Of course, that makes him more depressed because he's even a failure at suicide.
Yeah. Guy absolutely bears his soul. I mean, talking about going into a psych ward.
Oh,
how extreme is that? Is there anything our society would judge you more on than like,
I know
you've been in a psych ward? What shit, man.
What I always think of, and he barely touched that though, is like, he goes to his doctor and he's like, I don't know if I can keep going with this, you know, and the doctor, he's like,
oh, are you saying that you're,
are you on the
gonna
edge?
Take your life? He's like, why?
No, because
well, if you are, I got to put you into a psych ward.
Doctors have a responsibility that if they sense like something's like critical on the edge, suicide, anything like that, like they'll commit you. And so it comes down to like two doctors are now making the decision whether or not John has to go to a psych
hospital.
Well,
they gave him the choice. They said either we can commit you or you can go in yourself. Yeah. I don't know what publicly would be, you know, if this comes out later, what you would want more. And so he actually sat there and thought, like, if they commit me, then I won't be able to just walk out. And maybe that's the best thing for me.
Yeah, and that's what they told him. They're like, look, if you commit yourself, you can walk out the door whenever. But if we commit you, you're staying until we think you're better. And my thought is, dude, it's like AA. It's anonymous until it's not anonymous anymore.
You're in there with real people. And he talks about people, not real names, obviously, but he talks about people he met and that he tried to help through the process and that helped him through the process.
Yeah, but I'd be the whole time going, I'm a national figure. Totally. I'm a national figure. I'm a national figure. If this gets out, I'm fucked. You're like, how could you not? And psych ward, dude, that's...
I know.
You'd rather be accused of rape than being like, okay, you're just a nut then.
But that's the thing, man. The guy just bears his soul. Psych ward, cutting himself, suicidal thoughts, suicidal tendencies. He really goes out on a limb here.
Yeah. And I, that really quick, and we wrap it up, but that that suicide note, it was like, hey, to it was just like, sorry to everyone that I love and loved me, you know, whatever. And then this act is solely the responsibility of Bernard and Jacqueline Saunders, his mom and dad. May you burn in hell. And that's it. And it's like, wow.
Yeah.
You know, but his mom was doing stuff like his brother Bernie gets signed by the Quebec Nordiques, gets a $5,000 signing bonus. She's forging his signature and wipes it all out.
Yeah.
And then fakes leukemia for their sister after she's played them for everything she can. They're not buying it anymore. She knows their one soft spot is their sister Gail. Oh, I need you guys to hear me. Gail's got leukemia. So, of course, they jump in paying money. She's full of shit. She's just, you know, paying herself.
Just it's evil parents.
When you think about what your parents are supposed to be in your life, it's like the exact opposite of these two. And it's just awful.
Well, it's like he and his siblings had to bond together and protect each other because they were useless.
Yeah. Oh, it's brutal. But again, it's John Saunders, Playing Hurt, My Journey from Despair to Hope. And Jay, that'll be up on we'll have this interview and book through our Amazon link.
Yeah, go to DetroitCast.com under the Help the Show tab. You'll see our bookstore and you can go right through there, our Amazon link preferably to buy it. And it'd be great.
Yep. Thanks again to John Unitas Bacon. It was a lot of fun talking to him. I'm sure we'll do it again.